Hallelujah. 68 this morning, I think it was when I got up. Ain't that just? It just felt so good, crispy, nice and cool. Amen. My old dog laid out there in the yard and just smiled all day yesterday. It was good and cool. I think 83 or 84 was a high. Amen. That's good, ain't it? Let me go ahead and hit the announcements. Then we're gonna go to church. How's that? Brother Goolsby's doing better. Thank you for praying for him. Hopefully he'll get to go home real soon. Let's see, our other folks, about everybody's home. Miss Nikki is no better. She's about the same. But the medication she's taking, the antibiotic they made for her, has not caused a lot of reactions, so that is a plus. She did have some hives. But other than that, she's doing pretty good. So as far as taking the medicine, she's had several bad days. Yesterday was a very, very bad day for her otherwise, but they are getting some medication in her to try to help with the pneumonia that she's got. And, you know, everything's a battle with her. So just continue to pray for her. Pray for Miss Anita, Lord, to give her strength and grace as she deals with the situation there. Continue to lift them up in prayer, her and Brother Chad, and any other family members. I know the aunts and the sister, Miss Atina, and others are helping what they can, but they have to be careful if they've been out around other folks. They can't be there in the middle of that. So just much prayer needed there for that situation. So continue to lift them up in prayer. Good to see Miss Ann here. She had a good procedure. Everything went great. She's doing much better, could feel results pretty much immediately. So thank the Lord for that. And thank the Lord for good doctors. It's you know, every field of practice that's there, whether it go from mechanics to carpenters to doctors to preachers, nurses, bankers, every one of them's got bad seed. Somebody's bad in it. But don't let the one bad give the whole crowd a bad reputation. There's some doctors you don't like sometimes, but there's good doctors out there, and our little church knows several of them, because Miss Nikki's doctor is fabulous. You're not going to find a doctor or a doctor's team to work with a patient like they work with Miss Nikki. And I know it's not for money, because she don't have the best of insurances, and a lot of what they're having to do, they're just doing. And the doctor has done a bunch just of his own accord. So the other day they had to wait for the medicine being made, because it had to be made specifically for Nikki, to be shipped from Charlotte up here to the hospital to do. And his whole staff stayed over to take care of Nikki to get that trial run of antibiotic in her. That's pretty good, ain't it? The whole staff. I mean, you know how it is. Around most places, if you quit at 4, everybody stops working about 3:30. I ain't got no bosses in here, evidently, do I? Bosses would have said, amen. Amen. Or something like that, you know. But anyway, praise the Lord. God's working. God's put folks there to be a help and a blessing. Miss Karen's doing better. Brother Pope's at home. Miss Pope's at home, of course. Brother Steve and Miss Tammy are both doing better. They're not plumb better yet, but they're doing better. This COVID flat takes the juice out of you. And so they're trying to regain their strength. They're still doing live broadcast at present. So much prayer for the Calvary Baptist Church Union Grove crowd and others around the land that's going through things. Please pray for the churches in California. California has come totally against them. They're telling them they can't even sing in church. Plus, they're fining them for being there. Last I heard, there was over $50,000 in fines. And that's ridiculous. The constitutions of the United States of America, the very foundating constitutions for the United States of America, says that they're not to form a law to come against a peaceful assembly of the church. Okay? That's the Constitution. You can't write a local law and override the Constitution. That's not possible. So there's a lot of litigation, a lot of problems going to come out of this. And this is an election year. If you're not registered, you better get yourself down there this week and get registered.
Amen.
You've got a responsibility to us, your youngins, your grandyoungins, to be registered to vote. And you need to prayerfully, with God's leadership, vote. Amen. I ain't going to stand in the pulpit of Tabernacle and tell you exactly who to vote for, but I can tell you who you shouldn't vote for. Amen. Amen. And let's just put it this way. I wouldn't let him around my wife, my kids, or my grandkids. That pretty well tells you who he is. Amen? Amen. That dude is untrustworthy. If I've ever seen a bad guy with youngins, he's one of them. Red flags everywhere. Amen. He's a pervert, flat out, and does not need to be in any kind of a office whatsoever. So pray and vote the Bible. Amen. Amen. Let God lead you. And this is probably, we thought last time was the worst one, but this is probably the most important election of your lifetime.
Amen.
If we lose out in this, you're in trouble.
Amen.
How old are you, Brother Virgil? That's wisdom. You hear that? 80 years old, and he's been around a little while, and he stood for our country in the battle times. He's a Navy guy, right? Amen. So he sailed the rough tide, and he's telling you this is one of the most important elections you'll ever vote in.
Amen.
Amen. So pray very much for our country. Pray for the West. The West definitely hadn't been won lately, so pray much for the West. It's in troubles. California and Oregon and all that out there is it's crazy. So pray very much for that crowd and all that's going on. Brother Pope has a son out there in California trying to raise up a church for the glory of God. Brother Treber's out there. MacArthur's out there. There's several good, strong churches out there that's trying to do a work for Jesus. They're not overbearing in folks' families. They're just offering the gospel and offering good training for the children. And they can't stand it. The government can't stand it. And a bunch of hypocrites. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Won't let you do nothing, but they can go to their beauty salon if they want to.
Amen.
I don't think she made it to a beauty salon. Brother Mike, you might need to explain that to a few folks. I don't think they got that part. Amen. I got to quit. I know Angela's staring a hole through me over here for me to shut up and go on. So I'm going to hush and go. Amen. Y'all can't smile. I done cut all kind of jokes. Ain't nobody smiling yet. What's the matter with y'all? Amen. Amen. Your mother-in-law done moved in, didn't she? Yes, sir. When are you getting that done?
Thursday.
Pray about that. I don't know about y'all, but that's just not. I can take some cutting in some places, but I ain't too crazy about that right there now. So y'all pray much for Billy as he has that eye procedure this week. Phew. That'd take a steady hand, wouldn't it? Well, did they do that robotically, or did they do that? Got a laser thing you do it with. Donnie looking like he thinks he can handle it. He can handle them lasers. Man, all right, pray about that, will you? Pray for the churches. Pray the Lord help us. Amen?
Amen.
Do all we can while we can.
Amen.
Amen. Yeah. No, I wouldn't let him touch mine either. Amen. Miss Gail, yeah, remember Miss Gail? She's still, her battle right now is with workman's comp. And probably some of y'all's had the dealings with them at one time or another. That's one of the worst organizations on the face of the earth. I'll just tell you that. They give you a fit. And Miss Gail's needing some help. And they're really giving her a fit on all that. So pray some of them folks will get right. Amen. Amen. That's just what they need. Some folk just need to get saved. Amen. Because they have no compassion for other people because they have no compassion at all. So pray about that. Pray for Miss Gail. She'll get to something figured out and fixed up where she can get that pain fixed in her neck from the fall. Amen?
Amen.
All right. Anything else I need to mention quickly? Now, y'all see, y'all done took 17 minutes. Anything else? We're going to pray. Yes, ma'am. All right. Unspoken for Miss Kay. Unspoken there, Miss Phyllis. Unspoken, Brother Scott. Remember his family. Anyone else? Let's go to the Lord. Yes, ma'am. Oh, Carissa. Okie dokie. Y'all remember that. Amen. Pray for our youngins. I can't detail everything, but I'm just telling you, our young folks is in trouble today. And they need encouragement. They need help. There's a lot, and I've not got time to go into all the different factors or things that causes them to be down and out and depressed, but a lot's got to do with home life, and they need help. I come up in a divorced home. Mom and Dad separated when I was 9 years old, but I had a better life in a separated environment than most kids has got with two folks that's married. And I'm not being ugly. I'm being serious. A lot of young folks need some help. We need help in our schools. They need encouragement there. There some things that's being taught is not in an encouraging way. A lot of things being taught is not being taught as is not truth. So be involved with your kids. Know who they're talking to. Know what they're talking about. I ain't talking about spying. I'm talking about being a good parent.
Amen.
Amen. It ain't spying when it's already my privilege, right?
Right.
Thank you, Brother Scott. Everybody else asleep. Amen. It ain't spying. It ain't spying. That boy's phone's on my plan. There is no expectation of privacy. It's my phone, my plan, no expectation of privacy. Hello? You better hush. Amen. My Wi-Fi, I'm going to be nosy. Why not? Do y'all realize that in our area, they're snatching youngins? I can tell you things you don't want to hear this morning. Amen. You better pay attention to your youngins. It's your fault you started this. Amen. It's serious stuff. Very serious. You need to know who your youngins is talking to. Amen. One of the biggest factors that the, what do you call them folks? Kidnappers, it's snatching youngins. One of the biggest factors that they're using is the social media. So pay attention. Amen? Amen. All these missing youngins ain't runaways. Amen. Trafficking, yeah. Child trafficking, it's bad stuff. We went to a meeting. Some of us went to the meeting in March, I believe it was, or February up in Mount Airy, and they had a seminar or a class on this child trafficking. And the guy went over all that stuff. And the guy's the real deal. He's been in foreign countries and rescued kids that were in slave camps. Amen. They come from here, come from America. The guy lives within about 40 minutes of here that actually does that stuff. So much needed prayer. A neighboring church in Alexander County's having a class on that within the next few Sundays. It's necessary stuff. Amen? Amen. We're here to protect our children, aren't we? Amen. I want to protect their soul and their body. Amen. That's my heart. That's my heart. Amen. We love them. We want to do what's right and protect them and reach them for Jesus. Biggest thing kids need today is to know the Lord personally. Amen. It ain't whether or not they can make $100,000 a year. The most important thing for your children and grandchildren is they know the Lord as their personal Savior. Amen. If that was a rapture, where would your kids be? Right. And it's that quick. One of these days, it's going to be that quick. Church will be gone. They're going to be left. If they're unsaved, they'll be left behind. Amen. Be given over to strong delusions in Titus, and they'll be doomed for hell. Serious time. Amen. If you'll pay attention to the Israel calendar and what's going on in Israel more than just what's going on in the U.S., you'll find out where we're at on the timetable. I almost preached on that this morning, but we're going a little different direction, what time it is. But we'll deal with that just a tad in a minute. Amen? It's serious stuff, folks. It's real serious stuff. Amen. Let's go to God in prayer, ask him to help us, and then we're going to go to church. That'll be all right. Father, we love you. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for goodness and grace and mercy. Father, thank you for forgiving us. For when we fail, we come short. When we sin, we know that we have an advocate, the Lord Jesus Christ, that we can come to. Lord, you said if we'll confess our sins, you're faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Our Father, I ask you to forgive me, cleanse me, purge me, forgive our church, cleanse it. Forgive our country, Lord, I pray. America's done so many things against your will and your way, against your word. I ask you, Lord, you'd forgive her and help her to turn back to you. Lord, I pray you'd bless us once again in our country. Have your will and your way with us. Be with our sick folk, Lord. I pray those that's recovering from the COVID and others that's sickly, I pray, God, you touch them and help them and bless them in a special way. Ask you, Father, you'd be with those that have other illnesses, not just afflictions, Lord, but other physical hindrances. Lord, I pray that you'd be with them, touch them, and give them health and healing. Lord, we pray that you'd touch our children. Lord, as Brother Jacobs mentioned this morning, Father, our children need leadership. They need encouragement. They need guidance. Father, they need to know they're loved. And I pray, God, please, help us to help them. Lord, I pray that those that's lost and undone, that God, they'll get saved. I pray you'd help them to realize that Jesus is the only way to go to heaven. And they'll call on you as their personal Savior. Father, I also ask you for these other special requests this morning. Please be with them and touch them. Lord, pray you'd help the Clanton family. Lord, you know what they've been through this week. And I pray that God, you'd bless them and help them. Strengthen them, giving them grace. Undergird them. Lord, for this church family, I pray that you'll bless and meet the need of each and every one that's here. Lord, I pray for the parents across this land, the grandparents. God, help them to be wise, and Lord, help them to be aware of their children and the things that's going on in their lives. And we'll thank you for what you do. Help us this morning. Help us to worship you in spirit and in truth, for it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen and amen. All right, get your hymn books. We're going to sing. Stand up. You can't sing sitting down. What number are you going to do first there, Miss Angela? 118. Hallelujah. Good place to go one of these days. And it ain't going to be long. Amen. is fairer than day, and by faith we can see it afar, for the Father waits over the way to prepare us a dwelling place there in the sweet by and by. We shall meet on that beautiful shore. We shall sing on that beautiful shore the melodious songs of the blessed, and our spirit shall sorrow no more, not a sigh for the blessings of rest. In the sweet by and by, sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. To our bountiful blessings that hallow our days. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. Did you get an Eden? 45, number 45. Amen. Thank God for that. Amen. Would you be free from your burden? Of sin, there's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you or evil the victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power.
start singing. I just want to thank everybody for your thoughts and your prayers, the food, phone calls, text messages, coming to the funeral, hanging out with the family. It was really tough. And I really want to say a big thank you and a shout out to Miss Judy and Brother Curtis, because they had literally just gone to visit with us and had other plans for that night, but they stayed with us and was with us the whole time. That really meant a lot. And then for the message that he gave at the funeral on Monday actually stood out, and I had people who came to me and wanted to know where our church was. So a big impact there, and I appreciate a pastor who will stand up and tell the truth and ask people questions and not be afraid. And I do know that there were family members there that do not understand the whole concept of being saved. And there's going to be a struggle within the family, because that was the last of the backbone of the family. They lost their mother many years ago, and now that their dad's gone, then a lot of times the family will just fall apart. And I do know there's going to be some trials along the way, so y'all just keep praying for them.
You're all alone.
Praise his name.
Looking forward to that day. You know, I was sitting there thinking, and I looked around our congregation. You know, we've had five families that's lost their dad or mother or both this year. And the good thing about all five, they got a testimony of salvation. So there is going to be a reunion day real soon. There ain't but 41 or two people in here this morning, and I counted five families that's lost the dearest love besides a mate to them this year, a mom or a dad. That's a lot, isn't it? As Brother Joe Arthur said, Curtis, I don't know of a church that's went through what your church has went through, but you know what? We went through. It didn't take us out. Amen. Go to Matthew chapter number 16 with me this morning. I want to share just a few thoughts with you. Matthew chapter 16. We've come through some things. You know, we didn't get hung up in the valley and die there. Quit. Throw in the towel. Turn back. We've come through some things. And it's not easy. I wouldn't want to discourage or depress you any. You receive grace from God to where you can go on. But the loss of that dear loved one will be with you till we get to reunion day. Dad's been gone since 95. And I still miss him. And I know I'm a 55-year-old, 200 none of your business pound feller. I'd crawl up on his lap in a minute right now. I'm telling you I would. In my heart, I feel like that, you know. I feel like the kid. Like to crawl up on Dad's lap and take a minute or two. But you know, there's a blessed reunion day. And I say that in the right way, not in vain. There's a blessed reunion day. We're going to get together again and see our dear loved ones that's going on to be with Jesus. Amen, because they know the Lord. Amen. Most important thing today, most important thing of this day right now is, do you know Jesus as your personal Savior? Because you could go out into eternity before you get home. Amen, you don't know. Some crazy went nuts down in Alabama, I believe it was yesterday, at a Bass Pro Shop. It's hard to believe in Alabama at a Bass Pro Shop, some guy went nuts and shot 50-some rounds off towards the boat and in the ATV area. That's where I'd be, amen. Ain't that crazy? You don't know when you're going home. 5-year-old standing in the streets here just a few weeks ago. They walked up and took out a 5-year-old standing there in the street. Ungodly. That's demonic. That's demonic. That's all you can count that up. That's a devil inside somebody to cause them to do something like that. Let's call it what it is. Amen. Our land is being run over by demonic oppressions. Amen. That ain't just mean us. That's demonic, the devil. Amen. We need Jesus in our land, bad. Matthew chapter number 16, Jesus asked there in about verse 15, he asked Simon and them, says, but whom say ye that I am? And Simon Peter answered and said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. That's affirmative statements right there. That's an affirmative word, the. It's not just a fill-in. It's making an affirmation about this person, Jesus Christ. Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. all these other little gods is dead. Amen. Buddha, Muhammad, and the whole rest of them, they're dead. They're dead. I'm serving the living God. Amen. There's a difference. That's why the church is alive today. That's why the church is what she is today, is because we serve a living God, the living God. He goes on. Jesus answered and said unto him, Blessed art thou, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood hath not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. What he just said is, you didn't just thunk that up in your head. He said, my Father put it in your heart. Amen. It ain't just a thought that passed through. You didn't just read some little old book and get that. You've believed. Amen. And you know, when you call Jesus the Son of God, that's part of believing. Amen. Amen. Now, some folks will call him Jesus and some folks will call him Christ, but the Son of the living God is a statement. Now, that ain't my message. That's just got good right there. Amen. The Son of the living God. Amen. I know him personally, don't you? Amen. I called on him years ago. I ain't never done him right or done him good enough. But he's my Savior. Amen. He's my Lord. He's my God. He's my friend. He's my helper. Yeah, man. I'm glad I know Jesus. He's even the one that disturbs me sometimes. If I ain't doing what I need to be doing or I'm doing something I shouldn't be doing, he disturbs me. I mean, it's like he's right there. You know how it is. You done something you wasn't supposed to do, or you're doing something you ain't supposed to be doing. It's like somebody, he's right there watching you, huh? Amen. I'm glad, hallelujah, that we can feel that. Amen. Amen. It's real in my soul. Well, let me get to the message. It says in verse 17, and Jesus said unto him, Blessed art thou, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood hath not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. And I say unto thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Read that last phrase with me. And the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Get a hold of that, church. The gates of hell shall not prevail against the church. Honey, we ain't going down. We're going up. We're not going to lose. We fight some battles, but the main victory, we're going to win. Hallelujah. Amen. I got news for that crowd in California. They can fight the church, but the church ain't going to lose. They're going to win. Any way it turns out, the church is going to win. Amen. I surely wouldn't want to be any of those politicians, government officials in the state of California that's coming against a church that's doing a peaceful assembly and teaching their people to honor those that are in authority. Hello? We don't teach folk to be rebellious, fighters against the government. That's not part of our teachings. Y'all with me? Amen. Amen. Now, you come up in here on my people, I'm going to defend my people. Amen. You come up in my house, I'm going to defend my house. But we're not going looking for a fight. Amen. But we're going to stand our ground, praise the Lord. And the gates of hell shall not prevail against the church, against it. That's the church. I got to looking at this and thinking about the church. Y'all know that the church is fortified. Y'all know what that means? Young folk, give me a head shake. You know what that means? You know what fortified means? Y'all know what a fort is. Fort's a strong structure built around a little community or a little area. And it enables that area there, thank you, sir. It enables that area to defend themselves, to keep the enemy on the outside, fortified. Y'all realize we have a fortified church. Amen. It's fortified not because we sitting up in here, but it's fortified because of Jesus. Amen. Amen. This is the only organization in which the membership is based on a single qualification. Unworthy, but saved. You can become part of this organization. Actually, it's not an organization, it's an organism. Because it's alive. But you can become part of this organism, the church, in one simple action. It don't cost you no money. You don't got to go through that baptism. You ain't got to be voted in. The vote's already taken place. If you'll accept Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, you can become part of the church, the organism of the living God. Amen. Ain't that something? Amen. And he takes anybody that's unworthy. If you come up in there to the Lord and you think you're worthy and all that, you're so full of pride and sin, you ain't getting in there. Only the unworthy. Only those that'll humble themselves and say, I'm unworthy and he is worthy. I can't save myself, but he can. That's how you get in. It's the heart. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness. The only organization that you can get into based on being unworthy. You know, most of them will make you have to go through all kinds of clarifications, background checks before they let you be part of their organization. Is that right? Amen. The church, to become part of God's church, all you got to do is come unworthy. Ask him to forgive you. Trust him as your Savior, and you'll be part of the organism of God. Amen. You know, the church is like a bank. Y'all listen to me this morning. Get hold of some of this. Y'all know the church is like a bank. The more you put in it, the more your interest, the more you have interest in it. Bible said where your treasury is, there your heart be also. You know why church don't matter to some folk? They ain't putting nothing in it. They riding by it and, you know, they might even walk up in there and look around a little bit, but if they don't put nothing in it, they got no interest in it. Huh? So the more you put in there, the more interest you got in there. Amen. It's like having a dog in the backyard. If you don't ever work with it, you don't ever love on it, you don't ever play with it, you just throw it a biscuit once in a while, you ain't got much interest in that dog. But if you go out there and love on him and play with him and not get bit and eat up, you can have pretty good interest in him. Amen. Fishing boat laying in the backyard covered up with a bunch of canopies or whatever, and you ain't got a lot of interest in it. You don't care much about it. But if you use it and go out on it and have a big time, the more fun you have, the more interest you got in it. Are y'all getting hold of this? If you got money in your pocket, ladies, there's a big sale. You've got an interest in that sale. I got to do something for the women folk. Huh? If your foot fits in that shoe, then you got some interest in it. So the more you put in that shoe, the more interest you got in that shoe. Hello? All right, now I got you. So you got to put something in to have some interest. A lot of folks don't put nothing in. I don't want to, I really want to be respectful, Brother Scott, but your dad's still on my heart, so I'm going to use a few little things I'm thinking about, if that's all right. 89. New preacher come to town a year and a half ago, which would put him at 87, 88 years old. He showed up to face-to-face with the preacher and let the preacher know who he was. Now, he's 87 years old, but he still has a great interest in his church because he's invested in that place. Y'all still listening, right? So because he's got some interest, he wants to know who's going to run the show. And wants the runner of the show to know who he is. He probably told him how it was when they started building back yonder and started this whole thing. And spent a couple of hours telling him about it. Amen. And that's all right. I can take you out yonder to a couple that I've helped watch go up. One over here on the Miller Farm Road, and I couldn't do a whole lot but get in the way when they put that one up. I was a little feller. It's called Hillside now. When it was built, it was Crossroads, because Preacher Joe moved it from 4th Street there where the Crossroads is. All them, these five little streets come together there, and there's a little building still there that was a storefront building. They put a church in there. That's where he started Crossroads as the mission. Then he went out yonder and built on Miller Farm Road. He built Crossroads Baptist Church. He and my daddy and a whole bunch of other folks built. Amen. Got a little interest in that place over there. There's a lot of pretty churches around town, but there's a couple that's got my heart. That's where I come up at. You go riding down Shady Rest Road, probably bothers you a little bit, don't it? Because you got one there where you growed up at. They started over on Younger Avenue after we got done. Little old four-room house, we knocked the wall out. I helped knock the wall out, hallelujah. They said, we finally figured out something Curtis can do. They handed me a sledgehammer and I tore the wall down. I'm good tearing up stuff. You don't believe me? Let me work on some of your stuff. Amen. But that little old house over there meant a little bit of something to me. You know why? Because that's where I'd go and my Father in heaven would feed me a message that would help me. I'm trying to get to this point here this morning, a little bit about the church, and it's done quitting time. Lord help us. Y'all ain't going to get much here. Hold on. Every time I pass the church, I stop for a visit. So when I'm carried in, the Lord won't say, who is it? That's for a good little thing. I got that from Brother Ronnie Simpson, Dr. Ronnie Simpson. Amen. That's pretty good. I want to be part of my church, and I want the church to be part of me. See, church don't mean a lot to a lot of folks because they're not invested in it. How many of you want your youngest to love church? Do you? You want your grand youngest to grow up loving church? Do you? See, the more you invest in it, the more you show interest in it, they'll show interest. Right. Lord, help us, but I got a son that's 29 years old, or did he just turn 30? Lord, he'll shoot me if he sees this broadcast. 29 years old, and he's got a lot of the same interest that I have. Wonder why that is. Because that's where my interest was. And he's picked that up from daddy. So a lot of us are teaching our children where to place their interest. What's the most important things? The foundation. Let me just give you the outline. We'll go home. When you look at Matthew 16:18, it says, and I say unto thee, thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church. The foundation to the church is the rock. Now, let me give you something to help you clear up a little bit here this morning. There's some folks that teaches by tradition that Simon Peter was the first pope. Y'all ever heard that? Now let me give you some understanding of Greek, since I know Greek. I do. He makes pizzas over here at him office. Greek word for Peter here is Petros. The definition of Petros is a piece of rock. Piece of rock. Got it? When you read on down in the verse and he says, upon this rock, that's Petra, P-E-T-R-A. And that's a mass of rock. What's the difference, preacher? Simon Peter's a chip off of the old block. Simon Peter is a piece of the rock. Jesus is the rock. So when you study that and you study the words there, it's pretty simple what the Lord's saying. I'm the church and I'm going to build on me. Now, when you go over in 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 5 and 6, because some folks got this a little mixed up, I think the Lord helped Simon Peter straighten it out for us. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 5 and 6, ye also, as lively stones, are built up a spiritual house, a holy priesthood, to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God by Christ Jesus. Wherefore also it is contained in the Scriptures, behold, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone, elect, precious, and he that believeth on him shall not be confounded. Does that sort of clear it up for you? What rock the Lord said he's going to build it on? Himself. It's not Simon Peter that he built a church upon. He built a church upon himself. Jesus Christ is the chief cornerstone. He cleared that up in 1 Peter chapter 2. That was easy, wasn't it? See, if you follow the Scriptures will give you definitions, and the Scriptures will give you defining so you can understand what he's really saying. God built the church on Jesus Christ, the chief cornerstone. Amen? That should be the foundation of your family. What's your church? What's your family built on? You ought to teach your family the most important thing in life is church. You ought to teach your youngins as you're right, raising them up. Yeah, they need to learn how to read and write and do arithmetic and all these other kind of things. They need those things. They need skills to know how to do stuff. But the first most important thing they need is a Bible to know how to find Jesus, and they need to know Jesus as their personal Savior. Amen. Y'all do understand what schools were started for, don't you? Now look up here, kids. I know they probably don't teach you this in school, but look up here. Let me teach you something. Do you know why they started schools? So they could teach you how to read your Bible. That's what schools were started for, so that they could have a learning place to teach you how to read so you can read your Bible. Now, you probably ain't going to find that in your modern history books. You need to go dig up some old ones before they destroy them all. Amen. Amen. Somebody got rid of an old set of encyclopedias here not long ago. I wish I'd have got my hands on them now, because it's got some of the old history in it that they don't teach nowadays. Now they won't twist everything around. Say amen right there. The foundation for the church is Christ. He is how we stand. He is who we lean on. Solomon there in chapter 8 in the Song of Solomon, talking about coming up out of the wilderness, and there she was, his bride was leaning on him. We are the bride of Christ. We're the church, the bride of Christ. Talks about in Ephesians 5. We're the bride. We lean on him. We stand on him. We lean on him. We kneel to him. When we can't get up, he helps us get up. When we're worn out from the tolls of life, he helps us. Elijah's a good picture of that. He sent angels by to take care of Elijah, fed him two different meals, got him up and got him going again. Amen. Amen. when we need lifted up out of a horrible pit. The Psalms just tells us about that. I believe it's Psalm 34, verse 6, where he said, I was in a horrible pit, and he lifted me up out of it and established my goings and set me upon the solid rock. Amen. Christ is the head. Ephesians 5, 23, the husband's the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church. Amen. The church, the focus of the church is Christ. The focus of the church is the comrades. The focus of the church is the condemned. That's those that are bound for hell. See, you don't have to do something to be bound for hell. You're born a sinner. In iniquity we was conceived. We're born sinners. We have to get saved, born again, as the Lord told Nicodemus in John chapter 3, verse 7. Ye must be born again. Not join the church, not get baptized, not learn a catechism. Hello? Get born again. The problem with a lot of folks in their heart is they've never been born again. There ought to be a time of conviction. And with conviction, you can put your confidence in Christ and you'll have conversion. Amen? So there's the condemned, the comrades, and Christ. That's the focus of the church. The fashioning of the church. Fashioning of the church is by the contractor, the Lord Jesus. Except Psalm 127, 1 said, except the Lord build the house, they that labor, they labor in vain that build it. Except the Lord keep the city, the watchman worketh in vain. Unless God does it, folks, it ain't going to be nothing. We can get together and try to build a little old church and do all we want to do, but unless the Lord's in it, it ain't going to be nothing. It'll come to naught. It'll be in vain. You want a lasting, working something that the Lord can get honor and glory out of, let the Lord help build it. It's tough for a preacher that's got a heart to do things to come to the place. It's tough on him. He has to come to the place one day and realize, I can't build a church. And can't don't work too good in my vocabulary. I can't do that. I don't like that. I'm going to try anyhow. Huh? But I come to conclusion a few years ago that I can't build a church. It's got to be the Lord. Except the Lord build the house, they that build it labor in vain. He's the contractor. The fashion of the church, you think about the character of the church. Look up here, church, I'm going to give you something. What's our church's character supposed to be? Not conform to the things of this world, but to be more like Christ. When you blend in with everything else, you lose your identity. You lose your individuality. Basically, you lose your character. We need to be defined. Folks need to know who we are and what we are. Amen? Amen. Talked to Preacher Joe a little bit yesterday. He's still preaching the same old message he always preached. That's the King James Bible, led by the Holy Spirit, preaching the truth. Amen? Church has got to fight. We have conflict. We have conflict with Satan. We have conflict in suffering. We have conflict with sin. We have conflict with self. But you need to note that she's still going on after it all. You know, out of the true 11 disciples, one of them we know was the devil from the beginning according to the testimony of the Lord Jesus Christ on him. Judas was the devil from the beginning. The other 11 believed on Jesus. Those 11 all were martyred to death except for John. They tried to take and make a martyr out of John. They boiled him in oil, tried to kill him. He wouldn't die, so they put him on the Isle of Patmos. And the reason he didn't die is God wasn't done yet. God needed to give him the revelation. So you ain't going to where the God's done. Amen. Amen. So there's a fight. We've got a fight. But listen, we can win. We can win the fights. We win. We got Jesus. The finish of it, he's going to complete the church. He's going to complete the work. I believe it was Philippians where he said he would complete the work that he begun in us. He's going to complete it. You're not going to go home half finished. He's going to complete the work in us. He does the cleanse in Ephesians 5 where he washes us with the water of his word. But the good thing about the church and our finish, he's going to call us out. Now listen to me. I'm done. I'm quitting right now. 1 Thessalonians 4:16, for the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout and with the voice of the archangel, with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. We which are alive and remain shall be called up to meet them in the cloud. That's what's going to happen to the church. We're a called out assembly. We're going to get called out of here. But now listen to me. Matthew 24:36 says this, but of that day and hour knoweth no man, no, not the angels of heaven, but my Father only. I don't know when. I don't know when Jesus is going to call the church out. But according to what he's taught us to know, what wisdom he's given us, it's not going to be long. He's given us vision of the times. He's recorded in the scriptures what's going to be in the last days. He's taught us these things. And by what he's taught us, we know, not guessing, we know that time is short. The rapture's going to take place. Now, as I done a while ago, I want to ask you a question real quick. If that was the rapture, are you ready? If the Lord Jesus Christ stepped out on the cloud and said, come up hither, that quick we're going to go. There ain't going to be now. Wait a minute, let me get this. It's right now. When he calls us out, we're gone. Amen. If the Lord called today, are you ready? Do you know without a doubt that you're saved by the grace of God? Do you know that you've called on Jesus, asked him to forgive you for being a sinner and to save you? Do you know today that your sins has been covered by the blood of Jesus by faith? That takes place. It's real simple. All you got to do is say, Lord, save me! From a heart that believes, and that quick you can be put in the family of God. But the important thing is, have you? Do you know Jesus as a personal Savior? Has there been a change in your life? Have you been converted? At conversion changes something over. Have you been converted? Have you been changed? Is there conviction in your life when sin is present? I'll say this and back it by the Word of God. If there's no conviction, then there was no conversion. The Lord will convict you of sin. John 16, he's come forth to do that. You will have conviction in sin if you've been converted. Do you know today, without a shadow of a doubt in your heart, do you know that if the Lord was to call the church up right now, do you know you're ready to go? If for some reason God decided to take you home this afternoon, whether it be by a car wreck, whether it be some medical something take place in your life, I'm not saying this to scare you. I want you to understand you need to know. God wants you to know. God wants you saved so bad that he let Jesus die on Calvary. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Are you saved? Are you part of the church? Are you a soldier? Or are you on the sideline? I never cared much for sitting on the sideline myself. I think in 3 years of football, I got to play. I think I sat on the sideline one play. That's because I got hit right in the knee. And I couldn't walk because it was numb, wouldn't work, and I had to go to the sideline. And I missed one game because I'd sprung my thumb. So I missed two games in 3 years. I'm not much for sidelining it. Are you where you need to be with the Lord today? Come on, Miss Angela. We'll let Miss Angela play just a little bit. Give you an opportunity to come to this old-fashioned altar. Let's all stand. I'm going to pray. And if God's dealt with your heart, come get in this altar. Listen, you can do that in social distancing. There's plenty of room up here for you to spread out. Listen to me. Look up here. If you need some help, all you got to do is look up at me or motion for me to come help you. I'll take my Bible and show you how to know Jesus as a personal Savior. I'll do that today if you'll call on Him. I'll help you. But you just got to let me know. If you want to come pray, I'll not bother you. I'll leave you alone. It'll be up to you. Our Father, in the name of Jesus, I offer up my labors this morning. It's not much, but we've tried. I thank you for the Word of God. I pray you'll use it to work in the hearts of your people that's here. Those that's saved, help us to be busy, for the time is short. Lord, for those that's here don't know you as their Savior, I pray, God, right now that you'll deal with them in great conviction. Let them know that if they die without Christ, they'll go to a devil's hell. Please, God, you do the convicting part. You do the drawing part and give them the measure of faith that they need to be saved. And we'll thank you for that. Help them, I pray. Lord, please. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for forgiving us. Thank you, Father, for all that you've done today. Now have your will. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Altar's open. You need to come. Come on. God dealt with your heart. Don't wait. Just come on. Let God help you. Do you know the Lord? You got peace in your heart that you could go out to meet God today with no problem? Do you know Jesus? While these are praying, all heads bowed, please, just for a few moments. Nobody looking around. If you need to come, come on. I've asked everybody to bow their head. Nobody look. If you need to come, come on. Make it as easy for you as we can. You come talk to Jesus. Let the Lord help you. You can be part of the church today. You'll come believe and trust on Jesus. Repent of your sins. He'll save you. How about it today? Do you know the Lord? While nobody's looking, I want to ask one question just so I can pray for you. All I'm going to do is pray. I won't say nothing to you at the door. If you're unsure of your salvation, would you just lift up your hand? I'm going to pray for you. That's all I'm going to do, I promise. I won't say nothing to nobody. But you're unsure about your salvation, just slip your hand up, and I'll pray for you. Anybody? Anybody in here admit they're lost? Never been saved, never been born again. Let the preacher pray for you today. Father, you know the hearts that's here today. I pray that you have your perfect will. Save the lost, strengthen the saved. Help us to serve you. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. God bless you. We'll be back tonight at 6. Thank you for being here.